Hello, everybody, and welcome to our Google Hangout, a discussion of Facebook, social media, and privacy. And today's a great day to have that discussion because of Facebook's IPO, which it's now a little after 4 o'clock, and we don't have the exact closing numbers yet. But big surprise on Wall Street, Facebook went public at 38, and basically it's going to close around 38. So with all that anticipation, not a lot of movement there for investors today. But with me here, very, very excited, we have a very a great panel. Steve Rubel, who's Executive Vice President from Edelman, and he's also a thought leader in the social media space. He's one of the first people you'll find in virtually every new technology. So he's a must read and a must follow. And we have Jeff from Consumer Reports. There's Jeff sitting in the studio. And he's here particularly because the cover story of Consumer Reports this month was all about Facebook and privacy and raised a lot of interesting questions. And so, Jeff, I'm going to start with you because of that story and because the main topic of our panel here. Facebook, you know, obviously a lot of investors are interested in Facebook. Obviously a lot of people use Facebook. 900 million people around the world use Facebook. So how could 900 million people be wrong? What's the problem here if 900 million people seem pretty happy with the product?
Well, I don't think we were saying that everyone who uses Facebook is wrong. I use it. I think we were really trying to alert people to the fact that the information they put in Facebook, a lot of people may be reading it that they're not aware of, and that they need to be more careful, you know, about what they use it for.
So just give me a for instance. You know, I mean, all these people use it. What's so scary about it?
One of the things we found is that just a lot of people are posting, you know, their wall or their status updates, and they're making them public. And we know there's already a company in business just to harvest that information for government industry. So people are having private conversations, and everybody in the world is listening in.
So people volunteer this information. They seem to like doing it over and over again. Steve, what's your view of this? I mean, obviously people love using Facebook. So what's the problem?
Well, look, I mean, it's... Look, we every day many more people than the people on Facebook get into a piece of hunking metal that weighs around 2 tons, and has wheels and goes very fast. And you know, yes, and every day people are in those, and unfortunately they perish. But the vast majority of people don't. And so I think it's because they know how to, you know, drive a car responsibly. And so I think what was great about the Consumer Reports piece was that they explained to you that, hey, you know what, this is a great, wonderful social technology and phenomenon, but at the same time, it is also, just like anything else, you know, anything that's good for you can be bad for you. So I think what they did is what they showed in data just how real that is, and they gave it practical advice on how to manage that. So I think that some of the hoo-ha around their story was a little overblown, because what they did was really explain how to use Facebook responsibly.
So, Steve, I want you to talk more about that. The three of us were all on a panel recently at NYU that got pretty contentious. And one of the reasons we're doing this virtually online is because now we can't throw things at each other, so we're at an internet safe distance. But Steve used a metaphor that I thought was very interesting. There's the folks who are, I'm going to call them the privacy camp, who are saying, you can't trust Facebook to protect our privacy. That's like having the fox guards the hen house. You used the auto analogy, and you said, no, I think it's like pushing the auto industry to make safer cars. And it's hard to deny that there are engineers all over the auto industry who have invented amazing things to keep us safe. So talk a little bit more about that auto analogy and how we can make the Facebook privacy story like the auto safety story.
Well, right. So I think that there's two, in the auto safety story, there's a couple of people who are responsible. There's the government that has some degree of responsibility there, right? They set standards for auto safety. There's the car manufacturers, and who obviously have to obey the law and also the guidelines that are set forth, and obviously the union standards and all that factor. But obviously they also advance the science of safety. You know, let's look at the airbag concept. So I think what Facebook needs to do is the same thing. They have the government, and they have to worry about that and all the ramifications around that and how they protect consumer privacy. They need to, you know, put the airbags in the car to show people, like, you know, so that they don't, you know, make mistakes that are really, you know, horrible, and protect them. But then they also have to show them, hey, you know what, they also kind of need to give them driver's ed. And I think that, and I'm not sure, you know, in the auto industry model, the auto industry, that's not their responsibility. That's the responsibility of you know, state and local municipalities. I think in this case, that's where the analogy falls apart. But I think it's, there needs to be more education and awareness around what, around how to use Facebook, quote unquote, responsibly. I don't know if that's the right word, or carefully. And know what's worth sharing, when and how, and to make the controls as easy as possible, which I think Facebook's doing. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, I was just saying, I'm really glad you brought the car analogy, because as I recall, when I was a kid, there were about 50,000 people a year dying in automobiles in the United States. And until a guy named Ralph Nader came out with a book called Unsafe at Any Speed, people really didn't understand you know, why people were dying, or what changes would be needed. And even after he first did that, you know, for a while, the industry fought him on seatbelts, they fought him on airbags, and now, you know, the number of people that die in automobile accidents is way down. But, you know, back then, and it was a small percentage of the overall population, but people still felt that 50,000 people a year was a lot.
And look, you know, Facebook is not a near-death experience. It's, you know, it's obviously, you know, I want to make it clear that these are two very different you know, situations. But I do think there's some of that kind of, because it is a new phenomenon, a new technology and a new tool, dare I call it that, that a lot of people use on a mass level. And I think that there needs to be some sort of awareness around what to do with it and what not to do with it.
Right. Well, my point wasn't to compare it to as much as until critics and investigators came in and began to explain and educate people. That's when changes really started to happen.
And I think one interesting thing I'd like you to pick up on, Jeff, is this took a long time in the auto industry, and there are many industries we can think of, right? Where do you leave self-regulation to the industry, or do you need an outside government agency? Do you need a crusading journalist or consumer advocate to get involved? And so, you know, does Facebook need a Ralph Nader?
I think to some extent that was the kind of function I think we were serving. When we did the story, we didn't really see the kind of analysis that we did. And, you know, when we published a story and we indicated, for example, how many millions of people are sharing data on there, a bunch of critics went online and said, oh, you know, that's not really a lot of people and you're creating a moral panic. But there was no information before we published the story. And just providing the public with information about how much data is in that database is already a public service. People can, you know, whether it's policymakers or the industry or consumers can make decisions, but without the information of just knowing what, you know, what's out there, you know, that's the purpose that we serve.
Yeah, and I have to ask this question because you're here, Jeff. There were a lot of people who said, you know, Consumer Reports, they do this survey of the net every year, but this year, wow, it was really targeted at Facebook. I heard people call it a hit piece on Facebook. Was it a hit piece on Facebook?
I don't think it was. First of all, the survey, there was another story in the same issue that included all the usual stuff we do with state of the net survey, malware, viruses, identity theft. There was a lot more information. But I think that we decided to focus on Facebook, first of all, because it's by far become the dominant, you know, social network. It's a new phenomenon for people, with almost half the people in the United States on there now. It seems time to take a look at this, understand what people are doing there. It's the elephant in the room. You couldn't ignore it.
So we have some questions now coming in from readers over Twitter and over Google Plus, and either of you can answer this, and I think, Steve, you might have a particular interest in answering it. A fellow named Nathan has written in and said he's been off Facebook for over a year and will never go back because he's found a home in Google Plus. So that certainly implies that he thinks Google Plus is safer, he has more control. I know, Steve, I saw recently you posted that you were giving up on Google Plus because you didn't think it served your needs. But what does this say about the marketplace and about privacy and different social networks?
Well, first of all, a couple of things. I didn't give up on Google Plus because I don't believe in them. I think Google's a great company, and I think that they've that in terms of the technology, they have the best. I gave up because I just don't have time. I had to pick where I could engage, and I'm not superhuman, and I decided that for the most part that if I'm not updating my blog, you know, more than quarterly, which I'm not, I think then I have to kind of make choices. I'm updating my blog as often as the updated parchment. So I kind of need to stick with what I'm good at, and that's why I've done Twitter and Facebook. I think the platform's great. To answer to Nathan's question, terrific that he found a home there. I think that there's a there's a lot of people who are getting into PATH and that there's a limit to 150 friends in that. And so look, it's not meant to be all. It can be all things to all people, and so far the numbers seem to say that. I think there'll be lots of different social networks that win. LinkedIn is seeing a lot of success as well, in a different kind of veneer. So I think and there's been a lot of consolidation lately. A lot of we've kind of gone down to having lots of social networks down to two or three. I don't really view Twitter as a social network, because I think they're really more of a. I almost think they're kind of like the next generation of the newswire. They're not really a social network by design, because you can follow people one way. But I think there'll be a bunch of different ideas, and I think that's terrific that Nathan has found a home in Google, because there are definitely more buttons there.
No, I've been using Google Plus as well as Facebook, but the network effect is very profound, and the small number of people that I know that are on Google Plus. Just makes it less attractive just because of this few people to converse with. So for me, it wasn't even a question of being better or worse as a product, as much as Google's got a real hill to climb to get people to move over there.
From a privacy standpoint, though, Jeff, I think the question on the floor is, will the marketplace take care of this? Some people like less privacy, some people like more privacy, they're entitled to whatever they want, and can products solve this problem?
I think what Google kind of moved in a few months ago when they saw the issues that were occurring around Facebook, and they came in and they started introducing more controls, and they kind of, actually, it's been good competition. They upped the ante and they forced Facebook to start tightening up and creating more controls. Without the competition, quite possibly Facebook might not have done that as quickly as they did.
I think what we have to make sure doesn't happen is that social networking can't be a regulated industry. That would be bad. And so I don't think it's anywhere near that, but I could see in one day that happening. So the more that we try to, that the marketplace lets, and the competition forces each other to react, I think is great. But I think the other thing also is, I praise Consumer Reports for what they did, because what they did is they used the power of their brand, which is very well regarded, to shine light on just how much at times reckless abandonment is taking place. And I think that over time that, I don't want to call them a watchdog, but organizations, people who are kind of designed to be, helping us, will be able to guide us towards what are the proper norms. And I think we're all figuring this out together. It's so new.
I do have concerns about whether Facebook might become, a bit of a monopoly in this area. We don't know yet. But Zuckerberg's, in his video, he talked about wanting, every app and every product that people use to be, powered by and integrated with Facebook. There's a very strong resemblance to Bill Gates' initial mission for Microsoft in the beginning, which was a computer on every desk running Microsoft software. And he pretty much made good on that. So, it's never good when one company, comes to dominate a market. So this isn't as much just a privacy issue, but it's an issue of, just public interest.
In terms of the business model, Facebook... is right to fear mobile. I mean, that's like the biggest threat on the horizon to them. It's very disruptive. I think it's in some ways more disruptive than social networking was to to people who didn't get it. Mobile is incredibly disruptive because of the behavioral environments and the fact that you can't take creative and stuff it into a 3x5-inch screen comfortably. You could do more on tablets, but people, and there's an expectation that's being created. They're going to have to get creative in how they do that. And I'd like to see them use their money to think about mobile, and I'm sure they will.
We have smart readers. Someone tweeted that question right to us just a minute ago. What's going to happen with mobile now that Facebook's gone public? And you think they have an awful lot of cash right now to invest in it. But Steve, it sounds like you're saying that Facebook is at the same place in the starting line as almost everybody else when it comes to mobile?
Yes and no. I mean, they're not, because the time spent on mobile is huge for Facebook. And that number is just massive. The monetization options for them are not as robust there. And so I think they will have to come up with creative ways to do that, and I think they certainly can. They'll have to also, at the same time, figure out how to become a layer across other apps, because the mobile experience, whether it be on Android or Apple or any of the phones, tends to be siloed by app, as opposed to serendipitous and flowing like the web is. And obviously, there's a lot of web use in those devices, too. But
I was at a presentation yesterday by Mozilla in which they had studied the people's use of the Do Not Track feature that's just starting to come into play. And they found way higher usage of Do Not Track by mobile users than by desktop users, assuming that people who use mobile have a much greater concern about protecting information about where they are and their privacy. And so Facebook might face new challenges in the mobile environment, where people's behavior and sense of things might be very different than the desktop environment they used to.
Jeff, let's talk about that for a second. One thing that we haven't done, and we've gone 18 minutes into this discussion without doing it, so congratulations to both of you, is we haven't actually talked about a nightmare scenario in privacy. So mobile is a great way to do that, and I do think that that's, we're sort of talking around it. Jeff, imagine for me, or share with people, what's the worst kind of thing that can happen when you combine lack of regard for privacy with a mobile device that knows where you are and knows who your friends are? What kind of things should people be concerned about?
I think the risks in mobile are far greater than they are on the desktop, just because your whereabouts is a very sensitive matter, both for criminals or, up until now in this society, we've mostly had freedom of movement, unlike in certain other countries where people had used passes and national ID cards and stuff like that. The more that we're monitored and tracked, the way we go, I think that's very sensitive.
Okay, so I'm going to, did you want to jump in there?
No, go ahead. Okay, Bob.
Yeah, I'm going to play opposite day with both of you, because I think this is a really healthy exercise, and maybe
you said opposite day?
Opposite day. We're going to play opposite day.
Wow.
So Jeff. And I realize I'm not painting both of you into the corner, one's anti-privacy, one's pro-industry, but Jeff, I want you to imagine for me a regulation or a restriction on companies like Facebook that would go too far, that would hurt business and that would hurt people's free use of the Internet. So I don't want you to tell me something that a privacy advocate would support. I want you to tell me something that would go too far so that even someone like you couldn't support it.
Tough question.
You're getting the opposite question in a second, Steve.
I hope that was easier.
Who would go too far? Just limiting people's ability to share, limiting Facebook's ability to locate people. Come up with it. Think about it for a second if you want. Steve, I'm going to ask you the opposite question, which is, has Facebook gone too far? Have social media companies gone too far? Give me an example of something you would say, whoa, we have to step in there and stop them from doing this. What would be too much of a violation to you?
Well, I think they did that. I don't know if they went too far, but they certainly pushed the envelope a little far with that beacon program they had 4 years ago, and it was in their early days. And I think now they've matured as a company and they've grown. But at the time when that launched, they certainly were when people made purchases with the few companies that had adopted Beacon, it was shared, the default to share was opt out instead of opt in.
So you would buy something on Amazon and then Facebook would automatically tell your friends, hey, Bob just bought a video, maybe you guys want to talk about it, right?
Right, I think it used to be, I think these things were, or I think they did some sort of integration with Pandora,
mm-hmm.
Where when you went and you listened to songs, that was automatically shared without asking you first. And you had to then figure out how to turn that off. And that was this is circa 2008, I think. And I think they've learned a lot as a company since then. And also they had, the government also, did come down on them a little bit. And so now I think they're defaulting much more towards, to making experiences opt-in by default. And I think that was a key shift for them. And so I think that's where they, making things opt out first by design, so that, the default is that you have to that you have to uncheck this as opposed to opting in is I think just behavior that that the population won't tolerate anymore. And I think for the most part, they stopped doing that years ago.
Companies over and over again, they'll have discovered, you know, it's hard work to get people to opt in. It's very easy to get people to opt out. And if you want to have a big splash with a new product, it's best to start with a few million people by default, right? And so that, I mean, that temptation is always there.
Yeah, I mean, look, I think the key thing is that for all these companies to be transparent. You know, Path had an issue, you know, a couple months back where they were accused of using or uploading. I want to be careful here, but as I understand it, they were accused of uploading contact data to their servers without asking first of the user, and I think there was an outcry around that. And they've since kind of, you know, they deleted all that information off their servers, and they were very transparent, and they've gone on to do great things. So I think, look, there's going to be bumps for learning. I don't think they were intending to be malicious. I think that just it was a snafu.
Bob.
Jeff.
Yeah, I mean one thing I think that the government might do that would be a problem, and I think they've been trying to make attempts at this already is forcing Facebook to create a backdoor entry for the government when they want to get in to Facebook and actually get access to data, maybe even without a warrant. That's been a touchy issue for years. I think if people felt that the IRS and other agencies in the government could you know, muck around in their data all the time at will, I think that would people would clam up and stop using the service.
You know, we just had a question from a reader which basically asks, has social media done any more or any less to compromise privacy than the government has? So, you know, I think people are wondering, you know, who should I be afraid of? You know, Facebook, which is a service I use and kind of like, or the government, which is doing things that we don't even know about. So who's
I'm often asked for these nightmare scenarios, and when I tell people about companies snooping around, they don't get half as upset as when I tell them about the IRS snooping around.
Right. Yeah, I mean, the IRS already does snoop around on people's public Facebook pages, right? We have evidence of that. But
you know, Bob, I think an answer there is which government?
Interesting. Yeah, what do you mean?
Well, you know, what degree do foreign governments, you know, snoop on Americans, you know, and vice versa? So, I mean, that's an open question. I don't have the answer for that, but I think that, look, these are disruptive technologies, and they're going to create all kinds of new norms all around for all kinds of industries, you know, whether it be industries. I think also, by the way, the one thing I want to touch on, Bob, is that I think that business has a responsibility here, too. To be as transparent and as forthcoming as possible, and to be an advocate for what 900 million people should ideally know. And I'd like to see. I think that'll be a trend we see more as business taking the lead in helping to educate the public around what they should know, what they shouldn't know.
You know, most folks who look at privacy would say that there's a big difference between Europeans and Americans. One of them is, in America, we trust companies more than the government, and in Europe, most places, they trust the government more than they trust companies. So some of these sentiments are reversed based on where you are. But I do think it's an interesting question, who should you fear more, except for this? As we know, governments can now get data from companies just like another company can. And so while perhaps the government couldn't invade your privacy directly, it can invade it by insisting on a backdoor through Facebook or insisting on some other legal means to get data. So of all the, Jeff, if I had to ask you, what would be the biggest privacy issue that people should focus on right now?
I think probably worrying about government, getting at their personal information is, you know, I'm not saying, you know, people who are not doing anything criminal, you know, they say they have nothing to hide, but I know most people I know do not really relish the notion of some bureaucrat somewhere snooping around in their personal life.
Steve, what's the number one privacy issue to you?
Consumer awareness, just teaching people, you know, helping people understand what are the new etiquette and behavioral norms that are coming into play that we haven't thought about yet. I mean, you know, there's just, you know, one day, you know, I assumed that there were things that we ate with utensils, and then we got napkins. Okay, and everyone realized, hey, you know what, the napkin does, it serves a purpose. You wear it at a certain time, And so I think it's just a, you know, we, it sounds silly, but, you know, there was some year that napkins were invented. I don't know. I'm sure Wikipedia knows. Fashionable knowledge. And so I think it's like that now. There's going to be things that, you know, that we're going to find out. And is, look, no, it, the hard thing is to anticipate where this is going. We don't know. I mean, social media is becoming part of every connect, every experience. I mean, you go to a Broadway show, it's part of that experience. You go to a baseball game, it's part of that experience. You go to, I mean, the, you know, there's some people now that, you know, Louis C.K. makes a great joke. There's a great video of him on, you can find where he was on Conan, where he says that, you know, that people are in front of these, like, massive experiences like Times Square and New Year's Eve, and they're looking through it through a three-inch phone, you know, through their three-inch screen, you know, instead of like looking at it like, and he's like, there's like, he says that there's explosions going on in Acrobats, and people are looking at it through these screens, and they're tweeting it.
That's,
I mean, he makes, in the video, you should go find it. He makes a joke that if Jesus came back,
well,
you know, like everyone would be saying, oh my God, Jesus is in front of me.
I just hope we don't reach the point where to use any kind of product or service, you know, you have to sign in through Facebook. That would not be a good thing.
There's all kinds of norms that are going to be, you know, and look, I think to their credit, they have to push the envelope. They have, I mean, Mark's ambition, from what I've seen, I don't know him personally, but I've just seen him from what I've read, is, yeah, he wants to build a big company and make money, but I think he genuinely wants to change people's experiences and make them more connected. You know, towards the end of bettering people's lives, but also, you know, make money. And I think those two things can work. As it happens, they're going to continue to push the envelope. There will be things that come up that we hadn't anticipated. There will be new. I mean, look at the whole thing that came up with this frictionless sharing technology in news, and the media organizations are figuring it out, and the consumers are figuring it out, and, you know, and the, God bless them for trying to push the envelope, because if they don't stay, if they stay still, they're dead.
But their dealing with privacy has been more reactive than proactive. Time after time, they've only they've essentially apologized and fixed things over and over again after the fact, and they have not yet really incorporated privacy by design or privacy consideration, so that they don't have to keep, you know, saying they're sorry all the time. A mature company, you can move fast, but you don't have to break things all the time.
Let me add to that. We do a study every year called the Trust Barometer. I'm sorry, PR guy doing a plug. We are encouraging businesses to grab what we call the license to lead. So what I would like to see Facebook do more of is actually, like, you know, do more in the way of education, and, you know, go further in making the controls even more simpler than they are today. I think they've done a lot in the last 18 months. And they have to start to do more to educate people on both the benefits of social networking and what it can bring for themselves and society, but also on the way to, for lack of a better word, practice social networking responsibly.
Hey, Jeff, we can't have someone from Consumer Reports on with a big logo in the background there without talking about little black and little red circles, I think. And one of the readers actually asked a very direct question, which hopefully you can just spit out. We'll do this word association style. But from a red to black circle, when it comes to privacy practices, how would Consumer Reports rate the following companies? Are you ready?
Ooh, wow. Good question.
I think you really should ask me how I would rate them, because I don't really think I could, you know, can speak. Normally, our ratings are subject to a pretty rigorous scientific review.
Bob, but when I think red and black circles, I just think of checkers.
All right, Jeff. But we're gonna. Steve, I'll let you play too. So.
Oh God.
From a red to black circle, how would you rate Google with respect to privacy policies, Jeff?
The privacy practices.
Yes.
We call these little things blobs, by the way. That's our name for them. And I'd probably give them between a 2 and a 3, maybe.
Steve?
Remind me, the black is good, correct?
No, black is bad.
The red is good. I'm sorry.
The red is a 5. That's a 5 blob.
It's 1 to 5.
Bad me. Sorry. Okay, so with Google, I think it's outstanding, because, but I think what they haven't done is truly remind people that all those things are there. So, for example, they have a product called Google Dashboard that I think is phenomenal. It's google.com/dashboard, and they actually show you all the data they have on you. All is a long word. They show you a lot of the data they have on you. They show you how many emails you've sent through Gmail. They show you how many videos you've watched on YouTube. they show you, and you can get an email update on that once a month. And so I think that's a remarkable product that I'd like to see Facebook have. They also have something called Google Takeout, which is google.com, I think, /takeout, that basically says, okay, I'm out, I'm leaving Google, I've had enough, I want all my data. Great, here's all your data, you can take it. You can get your photos out of Google, you can get your videos out of YouTube, you can. Here's how you get all your Gmail out. And I think almost every Google product has that and they let you opt out of that, whereas I think Facebook does not even let you get your contact list data. So again, I think that they are way ahead of the game in terms of that. Now, I don't think that they do enough to remind people that those products are there because, quite frankly, it's not in their best interest.
So from 1 to 5, from red to black?
Red being 5?
Yeah.
4.5.
4.5 for Google, okay. How about Twitter? Jeff?
Privacy. Oh. I don't really have a sense of Twitter's privacy policies at all.
NA. We can take NA if that's your response.
Well, the one thing I'll say about Twitter is it's meant to be a public service. You know, the only thing that is private there, for the most part, is the direct messages. And so, like, I have not seen a way for me to take direct messages and export them. However, they send me every direct message I receive. So around direct messages, I don't know to what degree there are privacy tools for those for that piece of the product. The rest of it's public.
I would say that there were times when I was getting some really nasty Twitter spam. That seems to have gone away recently, but which I never experienced on Facebook.
Yeah, it's actually Twitter's done a remarkable job, I think, of getting rid of spam. So, Steve, did you have a 1 to 5 number you wanted to give Twitter?
I'm only going to put them in the middle because I really don't know.
Okay. How about here's one we haven't talked about yet? Quora. Quora. Jeff?
Who?
Quora.
They just raised a lot of money.
So who? Steve?
I don't use it. I mean, I did, but I have no idea. So I
think it's interesting we had a reader lump those in together, actually. So they're having
a lot. He or she should ask that question on Quora.
Yeah, and then the final one will be Facebook. What scale of 1 to 5? Start with you, Steve.
You know, I think they're today. I think they're a 4, or 3.5. I just think they need to do. They still have a lot more work to do to make the privacy tools simpler. I mean, I sat with somebody yesterday, and she was asking me questions about Facebook, and she's a very smart, sophisticated woman, and she was saying, well, how do I do this, and how do I do this, and I had to sit with her and, like, you know, kind of go through the settings myself to see, and it, you know, reminded me of, like, trying to change my screensaver, you know, back in 1994, and I had to figure it out, and I think they got a way to go to simplify that, so I'm going to say 3.5 to 4 right now, but progressing fast.
Jeff?
Well, I'd give them a 2, and our scale of rating, 2 is actually a fair. That's the word we associate with a 2. 1 is poor, 2 is fair, and 3 is good. So we actually have names, you know, for the different little circles. But I think that they've again been reactive rather than proactive, and you know there's a lot of stuff in there that's designed to essentially sort of encourage you to leave things open rather than lock them up. Some people think that conflicts with their business model, and that it's actually against their interest to default to more private kind of things because they want people to share. But I think that's also kind of a slippery slope for people where it's always up to you to be careful. I think that car companies are just trying to design safer cars these days. To go back to our analogy, I think. If they were, they should be trying to design a much safer Facebook.
So this conversation has been just fantastic. In the beginning, hopefully we'll have a chance to do it again. I really need to thank my guests, Jeff Fox, Steve Rubel. If you come in the middle of this conversation, it'll be recorded and put up on redtape.msnbc.com, and you can watch the whole conversation in its entirety. And, of course, thanks to all the folks who are watching and tweeting in questions. We'll do it again soon. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Thanks, Bob. Thanks, Steve. Take it easy.
Take care.